Good morning and welcome to worship with Greystone Baptist. Greystone's a place where all are welcome. It doesn't matter who you are or what you do professionally or in your spare time. We believe that here in this community of faith, all people are welcome and all of us are enriched by one another's presence. We're so glad that you've chosen to worship with us this morning. And if you'd like to learn more about our community of faith, we invite you to visit our website, www.greystonechurch.org, or to follow us on Facebook or Instagram, or on our YouTube channel where we gather each Sunday morning. Today, we are going to participate in communion. We're going to gather around tables in our homes, but trust that in God's Spirit, somehow, some way, we are united together when we share those precious and simple elements of bread and drink. And so if you haven't had an opportunity to go ahead and set your communion table in your worship space this morning, we invite you to pause the video and go ahead and prepare whatever it is that you have available for communion today. Today we're continuing a series on discipleship in which we've been asking ourselves, what does it mean to follow Jesus? What does it mean to be a disciple of Christ then in the Bible? And what does it mean now? So we've read some stories from the Gospel of Mark, and we have considered some pretty difficult questions about what does it mean to place our identity and our allegiance in Christ and Christ alone? And what does it mean and what is required to say yes when God comes calling with a difficult ask? Who are the demons in the world that are ripping us apart and tearing our relationships? And how do we name them and call them out so that God might purge them from our lives? And today we read a story of healing. And we ask ourselves, what are the ways in which we need to be healed so that we can more fully and faithfully follow God in the world? And what are the ways in which we are being called to be a healing balm for our broken world? Today, let us begin worship by lifting our voices together with our song, Call to Worship. Let us worship God this day.
Love is not always comfortable, and truth isn't always so clear. So push us, pull us, shape and transform us, open our hearts to you. Love is not always comfortable, and truth isn't always so clear. So push us, pull us, shape and transform us, open our minds to you.
Live into hope of God. It's so good to see you today. Can you do me a favor and hold out your hands? Take a good look at them. In our Bible story today, you're going to hear about hands a couple of different times. You'll hear about Jesus, who went into a room and took the hand of a sick woman, and with his hands, he healed her and made her better. And as soon as she was healed and she wasn't sick anymore, she got up and used her hands to help others. A little bit later in the story, you will hear about how Jesus used his hands and prayed. And when the disciples came and got him and said, "Everyone's looking for you," Jesus said, "Let's go. Let's keep going to more towns and teaching and healing and praying and teaching others." So I got to thinking about our hands and thinking about there are all kinds of things that we can do with our hands, right? Can you name some of them? Right, we can play games with our hands, we can do schoolwork with our hands, we can cook, we can eat, we can play, we can dig, all kinds of things that we can do with our hands. All the things we just said are all good things for us to do with our hands, right? But do we ever let our hands do things that are maybe not so good? Maybe we use our hands to hit our brother or sister. Maybe we use our hands to sneak food out of the pantry when mom and dad aren't looking. Maybe we use our hands to write things or draw things that are not very kind. There are all kinds of things that we can do with our hands. And just like in our story today, all of those people use their hands to do good things. So I want you this week to try to use your hands to do the very best things that you can do with them. I have a prayer for us. We're going to use our hands, so I want you to leave your eyes open and pray with me. Go ahead and get your hands ready. God, you created our hands beautiful and capable, but too often we use them to grab what we want. We ball them up into fists to hit. We only use them to hug ourselves. We hide them behind our back, pretending there's nothing that we could do to help when we know there really is. So we turn our hands to you, asking for forgiveness. Forgive all of the wrong that we have done with our hands. Wash our hands and make them clean. Lead us to use our hands well. Teach us to open our hands to share with others. Give us the power to wave hello to our neighbors. Show us how to use our hands to join with our neighbors and build your kingdom of love. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
It's been a long, dark night. I've been waiting for the morning. It's been a long, hard fight, but I can see a brand new day dawning. I've been looking for the sunshine, 'cause I ain't seen it in so long. Everything's gonna work out just fine. Everything's gonna be all right. That's been all wrong. 'Cause I can see the light of a clear blue morning. can see the light of a clear blue morning. Everything's gonna be all right. It's gonna be okay. It's been a long, long time since I've known the taste of freedom and those clinging vines. They held me bound. Well, I don't need them. Ooh, I've been like a captured eagle. Can see the light of a brand new day. I can see the light of a clear blue morning. Everything's gonna be all right. It's gonna be okay. 'Cause I can see. I can see, I can see the light of a morning. It's gonna be okay. Everything's gonna be all right. It's gonna be okay.
And now let us pray together. Almighty and merciful God, as we stand in awe of the magnificence of your creation, we thank you for the precious breath of life you have given to each of us. As we gaze upwards to the stars and the heavens during these long, cold, and clear nights of winter, we recognize in this stark beauty our frailty and weakness. We look forward to spring's warmer weather, the blooming of flowers, the nesting of birds, and the stirring of wildlife, for they remind us of the continual renewal of your creation. Perhaps in these difficult days, spring represents to us the joyous return of in-person life and the rejuvenation of our spirits. For we now find ourselves overwhelmed with a pandemic that has isolated us physically and emotionally. Even as we connect with each other through a computer screen, we feel veiled by technology in a virtual world that seems unnatural to many of us. And political forces which drive us apart, rather than together, label or demonize those who may be different from us and obscure truth to advance causes which threaten the fragile stability of our communities and nations is not helpful. Oh God, we hunger for healing of both our bodies and our spiritual selves. We pray for your Holy Spirit to move within us. We pray for endurance, patience, and courage, for caregivers and medical professionals who tend to the sick, for the teachers and parents who educate and care for our children, for first responders and all those sworn to defend and protect us, even as they risk their own lives. We pray for the wisdom and compassion of our governmental leaders in addressing the critical needs of the nation, for strategic, clear vision, transparency, which reassures rather than confounds, for civility, which respects the dignity of every person, which joins families that have been separated, and which strives for a lasting peace. We pray for the restoration of community in our schools, our workplaces, and in our recreation. In our houses of worship, we pray that we can once again see smiles now hidden by face coverings, laugh and cry together, pass the peace to another, hug those we have missed or who need reassurance, and celebrate the solemn as well as the ordinary moments in our lives together. As we seek our own healing, may we see more clearly into the eyes of the desperately poor, the hungry, the lonely, and all who suffer, that we may better minister to and serve them. May our new normal way of life be one in which we try to be more like Jesus. Let us love each other now more than ever. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Mark 1, 29 through 39. As soon as they left the synagogue, they entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. Now Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they told him about her at once. He came and took her by the hand and lifted her up. Then the fever left her, and she began to serve them. That evening at sunset, they brought to him all who were sick or possessed with demons. And the whole city was gathered around the door. And he cured many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons. And he would not permit the demons to speak because they knew him. In the morning, while it was still very dark, he got up and went out to a deserted place, and there he prayed. And Simon and his companions hunted for him. When they found him, they said to him, "Everyone is searching for you." He answered, "Let us go on to the neighboring towns, so that I may proclaim the message there also, for that is what I came out to do." And then he went throughout Galilee, proclaiming the message in their synagogues and casting out demons. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Today's gospel reading from Mark picks up right where we left off last week. Jesus, followed by the four new disciples that he'd literally just pulled off the fishing boats, they leave the synagogue in Capernaum. And in that synagogue, when they had gathered there, Jesus performed the first miracle in Mark's gospel, casting out a demon. From the synagogue, Jesus and the new disciples then go into the house of Simon and Andrew, where Simon's mother-in-law is sick and in the bed with fever. Unlike the exorcism text from last week, this story sounds like something we can relate to, something we can easily understand. After all, we have all been sick in bed with fever, haven't we? But in the ancient world, things were a little bit different. Then, illness could have a catastrophic impact on the household economy. Everyone had their roles and responsibilities. They were all part of an intricate web of mutuality. The men found work outside the homes, earning money to provide for the family's needs. You may remember that Simon and Andrew were fishing on the boat with their father when Jesus called them, when he said, "Come and follow me." The women had just as much responsibility with their work in the home, teaching and tending the children, the wash, the food, and sometimes even the farm. When anyone was sick, to the point of being stuck in the bed, an important link in that web was missing, and the whole household suffered because of it. Illness and disease also carried social and religious consequences for those who were sick. They were considered impure and unclean for a period of time, and therefore they were excluded from sacred spaces and from the communal worship of God. Isolation could quickly set in as the infirm were unable to perform their familial responsibilities, and at the same time, they were cut off from their religious communities. This combination of conditions created a dual diagnosis of sorts. A biblical scholar, John Pilt, wrote about this in 1985, saying, "Ethnomedicine places primacy on the culturally constructed causes of illness. In contrast, biomedicine places primary emphasis on disease, biological symptoms, and pathogens. Disease derives from a biomedical perspective. Disease affects individuals. Illness, however, inevitably affects others. The significant other, the family, the neighborhood, and even sometimes the village. Jesus, Pilch says, and all other healers of his day could only perceive illness and not diseases. Notice in each healing instance in the Bible the almost total disregard of symptoms, something that's very essential to curing diseases. Instead, in these stories, there is a constant concern for meaning. Jesus' activity, therefore, is best described as healing and not as curing. He provides social meaning for the life problems that arise out of sickness. To use Pilch's logic and language, Simon Peter's mother-in-law, when we meet her in Mark's gospel, is suffering from both disease and illness. She had a medical problem, and she had a sociocultural problem. Both were in need of healing. Now, until very recently, that kind of unique situation would have been difficult for us to imagine. Since the first century, we have learned so much about the causes of our sicknesses, and we have, for the most part, concluded that our physical maladies are not always a direct consequence of our spiritual piety. Despite the temporary setback of a cold or a stomach bug, we have become accustomed to the endless opportunities that we have to do our jobs, to carry on, to function in society, and to engage with our friends and family at will. But this pandemic has taught us a little something about the dual diagnosis of disease and illness. If we didn't know it before, now we know that our bodies are not immortal. We are not immune from the things that threaten our health. There are germs and bacteria and viruses that we can carry and spread, and they can cause tremendous harm to ourselves and to others. So we have taken efforts to isolate ourselves, to wear masks on our faces, to stay socially distanced from one another, and if we didn't know it before, now we know that prolonged periods of being alone and at home can make us feel like we aren't even ourselves anymore. That kind of isolation can make us act out in ways that we don't even recognize. Until recently, we might have struggled to understand the dual nature of disease and illness that kept Simon's mother-in-law sick in bed and that separated her from her whole world. But now we can begin to understand, because we too are in need. We too are in need of both kinds of healing. Healing that might come in the form of a vaccine, and healing that might come as our church begins to regather. Aren't we all in need of healing? When Jesus enters the house of Simon and Andrew, he immediately learns that Simon's mother-in-law is sick. Now, I wonder why they told Jesus about her. I wonder if they told Jesus about her because they needed to explain why she wasn't there to greet them at the door, or maybe to explain why the other women seemed a little bit flustered trying to prepare to receive their guest. I wonder how long she'd been bedridden. Did the fever come on that morning? Or had she been out of it for days, or weeks, maybe even months? And no matter the answers to these kinds of questions, Mark tells us that with no regard for purity or piety, Jesus immediately goes over to where she was. He goes over to her and reaches out and takes her hand and lifts her up. This is the first time in Mark's gospel that the Greek word for lifted up appears. And it's the same word that Mark will later use to describe Jesus' resurrection from the tomb. Perhaps the author is trying to imply that this woman is experiencing her own resurrection of sorts as she is transformed from a sick woman in bed with fever to one who has been healed and called a servant of Christ. On March the 10th in 2016, a campaign rally was held in Fayetteville, North Carolina. The event was disrupted by protesters until finally law enforcement officers had to lead the protesters away. And as they did, a 79-year-old white man named John McGraw, who had come to attend the rally, he stepped out from the crowd and he punched one of the detained protesters, a black man named Rakeem Jones. John McGraw punched him in the face. And after the incident, McGraw said on video, "He deserved it. The next time we see him, we might have to kill him. We don't know who he is. He might be part of a terrorist organization." McGraw was arrested that day and charged with assault. And the next time that the two men saw one another would be months later in court. McGraw did not contest the charges on that day, and he apologized to Jones after the legal proceedings, saying, "If I met you in the street and the same thing occurred, I probably would have said, 'Go on home, or one of us is going to get hurt.' That's what I would have said. But we were caught up in a political mess. We all are, you and me, we are caught up in a political mess, and we've got to heal our country." Now, later on, at Rakeem Jones' request, the two men decided to meet for lunch, and they began the long and deeply relational process of true healing. Rakeem Jones and John McGraw suffered from a common illness, an illness that is wreaking havoc in our society today. They were ill with politics and ill with socioeconomic difference. They were ill with the lie that our society can only thrive when we exclude and evict our neighbors. They were ill with racism. They were ill with hatred. They were ill with prejudice and self-righteousness. They were ill with anger. They were ill with fear. They were so completely ill with all kinds of conditions that kept them quarantined and separated from one another. But fortunately, what McGraw and Jones learned throughout this whole ordeal was that the only way to heal was to draw closer to one another, not through anger and violence, but through love. Bishop Michael Curry says it this way: "There is one thing that we can all be sure of," he says. "Whatever the future holds, it will be shared. We will either live together as family or we will perish as fools." That faithful encounter between Jones and McGraw, it happened nearly 5 years ago, and it pains me to say this, but I don't think a whole lot of improvement has happened since that day in 2016. We have continued to pick one another apart, allowing superficial arguments over small points of difference ruin relationships and deepen divides that exist between ourselves and our neighbors. Yes, I know I'm talking about a political reality, a political problem. But as Christians living in the United States of America in 2021, it is time to admit that we have allowed these external divisions of politics and political ideologies to come on into the church and to tear us apart just as much as they are tearing us apart out there in our world. We started this journey in January, a journey of understanding discipleship and letting the Bible inform that understanding. We started in January by remembering who we are and remembering whose we are. We are God's beloved children, and we are followers of Jesus. We are disciples of the risen Christ who taught us how to live in peace with one another. And we begin with accepting the blessing of God's belovedness in our own lives. And we say yes to God's calling on our lives, a calling that compels us to go out in the world sharing that promise. You are God's beloved children. We're also called to name and to cast out all the demons. The demons that breed false teachings about who we are. Lies that rip at our souls from the inside out. And so together, as one body of Christ in the world, we say no to all that is unclean within us, among us, around us. And then we get to the work of healing. Healing those who are sick with bodily diseases. And healing those who are suffering societal ills. That is our work. That is our story. That is what it means to be a disciple of Jesus. After Jesus heals the woman in Mark chapter 1, the woman gets up. She is lifted up by Jesus himself, and immediately she begins to serve those around her. And this is the first time in Mark's gospel that anybody's actions are described with that word to serve. And Mark will continue to build upon that concept of service, using it to define the work of the other disciples and also the deacons. You see, this is the first deacon in the Gospel of Mark. She sets the tone for what the other followers are going to do and become: followers of Christ, servants of others, waiters of the tables that bring people together. And after word gets out that Jesus is casting out demons in the synagogue and healing the sick woman in her home, others from the town, they begin to show up in search of their own healing. Soon the whole town has gathered, and Jesus begins to heal them too, all of them, casting out demons and healing the sick. Often we read these stories about how Jesus healed the sick, and we imagine in our mind's eye whole cities full of people with physical illness. But I think there's something more going on here than the stomach bug. There's another kind of activity happening with Jesus' healing work in Capernaum. People are coming together. Relationships are being restored. Those who were cut off and isolated because of ideas about purity and piety, they are brought back in. They are lifted up. They are restored. They are set free from the burden of their illness. And it's no wonder that the crowd started to grow. And the scripture says everybody wanted to know where Jesus was. Perhaps it was because he was healing them all in ways they didn't even know healing was possible. Perhaps we're more like them than we thought. Maybe we are in need of medicine. Maybe we could benefit from a vaccine to heal our biological sickness. But I think we are in greater need of a Savior who can heal our relational illness. Michael Curry says that we need a revival of relationships, of human relationships across difference, Differences of religion, differences of ethnicity, differences of political ideology. And as the former Secretary of State, Madeleine Albright, said, instead of conspiring with the like-minded, we need to spend more time learning from those who we consider wrong-headed. As Christians, as followers of Christ, disciples of Jesus, we already know how to do that kind of work. We know it because we do it on a regular basis. Every time we gather around our communion tables, when we sit down together and we give God thanks for this simple meal of bread and drink, and when we pass those elements to one another, not worrying about all the little things that we have to disagree about, but rather focusing on all that we share in common. The scripture says that the sick woman was lifted up from her illness. She was resurrected from her old life and transformed into something new. A servant of God, a disciple of Christ, a deacon in Christ's emerging church, an agent of love, a source of healing, and a prophet of wholeness for a world that desperately needed it. What do we need to be saved from and lifted up from today? What kind of healing do we need? And could it start right now? Perhaps as we prepare to receive the gifts of bread and drink. The bread of life, the cup of the new covenant, poured out for you and me and all the world. Amen.
A shelter, a space, a safe place. This is for us the one place that we find ourselves sharing a meal with people who are different from us. Yes, I know right now we're in our homes with people who are probably a whole lot like us. But even as we gather around today, we do so in solidarity with other Christians around the world and with our sisters and brothers of Greystone Baptist Church, our very own beloved community. We are all participating in this holy meal today. When we share in the practice of communion, it doesn't really matter where we are because we are united through the Holy Spirit. And so today, in spirit, we are all gathering around this, Christ's table. This table is the one place for so many of us when we're invited to pass the bread and the drink to the one who sits next to us, whether they are a stranger or a friend, whether they are like-minded or see things from a completely different perspective, whether they are old or young, whether they are strong or weak, whether they're as rich as we are or as poor as we are, whether they seem to have it all together or if everything in their life seems to be falling apart, we are all one when we gather here at Christ's table. One people, broken and in need of God's healing touch, which so often meets us right here at Christ's table. Let's pray together. Gracious God, we come to the table weary from all that has unfolded around us and within us in these last weeks and months. Many of us are carrying the burdens of worry as we face futures unknown. Many of us are carrying grief for loved ones lost. Many carrying the pain of hopelessness as this season of pandemic seems to go on and on without end. We are anxious about all that we cannot know and all that we cannot control and all that we cannot understand. And from these anxious places of worry and sadness, we recognize that now more than ever, we need one another just to make it through. And even though we know deep down that we need each other, we have become very, very good at finding reasons to argue, reasons not to trust, reasons to ignore, and to write off those who do not agree with all of our perspectives. Forgive us. In these moments of brokenness, God, draw us back to this table through memories and through present moments when bread and drink are shared. Remind us that this is how we begin to heal, by drawing near to one another, by listening to one another, by inviting one another to the table and asking if we can pass the bread. This is the first step to healing. And we need to remember that you've taught us how to do it in the sharing of this holy meal. Loving God, we ask that somehow, some way, you might grace us with your presence at our tables today. And in your presence, heal us, renew us, make us whole. In your mystery, O God, transform these simple gifts of bread and drink into a healing balm, nourishment for our sick and dying world. God, as we receive these gifts, call us forward and outward, sharing all that we have received here. We ask these things in the name of Jesus, who is the Christ. Amen. Sisters and brothers, today, like so many other days, we find ourselves here at Christ's table. And each time we gather at this table, we are reminded of Jesus, who during the last week of his life found himself around a table with his closest friends and followers. And over the course of the meal that they were sharing together, Jesus took the bread, a simple loaf of bread, and he gave thanks, and he blessed it and broke it, saying, "This is my body, broken for you. Take and eat. In the same way, also, he took the cup, and as he poured it out, he said, "This is the cup of the new covenant poured out for you. Take and drink." Sisters and brothers in Christ, the table is ready. Come now, bring all the faith that you have to God's table of grace.
When we are creators of justice and joy, compassion and peace. Yes, God will delight when we are creators of justice, justice and joy.
Thank you for worshiping with us today. Everyone is invited to join us on Zoom for an interactive time of worship on Ash Wednesday, February 17th at 7 p.m. The Zoom link and meeting information will be in our Thursday e-newsletter. Ashes and printed worship guides will be available for all church members who would like to participate to pick up on Monday, February 15th between 5 and 6 p.m. At that same time on February 15th between 5 and 6 p.m., families with children can pick up their Lent at-home kits. Pastors Chrissy and April look forward to seeing you at this drive-through on February 15th. For the season of Lent, the Greystone staff will be practicing self-care. Oftentimes, we think about keeping Lent in terms of giving something up. But this year, we want to take on self-care as our Lenten commitment. Each member of the staff will be writing a blog post to share how they are engaging in self-care as a kind of permission, invitation, or maybe even a challenge to the congregation. We will, of course, continue to offer worship services each week, as well as our Wednesday morning prayer meetings and the Ash Wednesday Zoom service I already mentioned. But as a way of practicing self-care for our church community, we'll be inviting teams and committees to consider whether or not they need to meet during Lent, and we will not have Wednesday night programming. We hope this will be a rejuvenating time of rest from online events, and we hope that all of us, individually, will experiment with and experience new ways of connecting with the Holy Within. Today is Super Bowl Sunday, and we'd love for everyone to be able to enjoy the game, so our youth schedule is a little different. Please check your email for tonight's plans. And finally, as we listen to this week's sending music, I hope all of us are moved and inspired to go out and be disciples as we walk with God in the world.
We will walk with God, my brothers, we will walk with God. We will walk with God, my sisters, we will walk with God. We will go rejoicing till the kingdom has come. We will go rejoicing till the kingdom has come. See the humble nage, oh, 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 see the humble nage. See the humble nage, oh, 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 see the humble nage. Nunca winda, una, see the humble nage. Nunca winda, una. We will walk with God, my brothers, we will walk with God. We will walk with God, my sisters, we will walk with God. We will go rejoicing till the kingdom has come. We will go rejoicing till the kingdom has come.
Sisters and brothers, as you leave this time of worship and go back into your world, back into your everyday lives, may you go forth with this blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May God's presence always be alive within you, giving you the grace never to sell yourself short. Grace to risk something big for something good, and grace to remember that the world is now too small for anything but truth. And too dangerous for anything but love. So may God take your feet and walk with them. May God take your hands and heal through them. And may God take your hearts and set them on fire. Amen.